Welcome to The Kitchen Table, a conversation about faith, music, and culture. Join Shine.fm's ministry director, Brian McIntyre Utter, and his son, Jake, around the table for this week's chat.
Welcome to The Kitchen Table Show. My name is Jake.
I'm Brian.
And we are glad to have you here. The reason we started this show, I went off to college. I'm actually starting my second year. And Dad wanted to continue having these faith discussions with me and faith conversations. And so we really wanted to encourage parents and children to have these faith discussions and to just be open about talking about the hard questions of faith. The way this show runs down, we have this faith discussion and we kind of pick from a basket of just hard questions that Christians have to go through. And then we move into Music Matters. Music Matters is a section where we just talk about the music that's impacting our lives. Dad brings a new song. I bring a song of the week. And then Dad, as he has always done with me, has always brought in an old song to
teach you the old ways.
Yes, teach me the old ways. And then we move into Culture Shock.
And Culture Shock is just whatever we find that's happening in culture and how someone is possibly making a difference for the kingdom or just something we find fascinating that we thought you needed to know about. So that's basically Culture Shock. So today we're talking about a topic that is very prominent in the news today when it comes to a certain one of these, and that is the topic of addictions. If you saw in the news this week, you know that our culture has an opioid crisis going on right now. It is prevalent throughout our culture. And there was a case in Texas. The company Johnson & Johnson, huge company, now is fined almost $500 million for their role in the opioid crisis. Of course, they're going to fight that one, I'm sure, and try to overturn it. But I want to talk about addictions because it's not just opioids that are a problem, you know, with addictions. There are many addictions in life. In fact, most of us probably have an addiction or an obsession of some kind, whether it's food or whatever. First, a story of addiction and addiction overcome. This is the story of Alex. Alex grew up a Cub Scout. He was involved in sports, had a nice family, life was good. And then he hit middle school. And that's when things in his life started changing. When he was 13 years old, he started using marijuana. He started hanging out with people who were smoking, and one of his friends asked him, "Do you want to try this?" And so he saw that they were having a good time, heard it wasn't as bad as what the school anti-drug programs were saying, and so it changed his thoughts as his life was changing. So he thought, you know what? These people do it. They don't seem horrible. So he started smoking marijuana on a regular basis at 13 years old. Started hanging out with lots of people smoking pot and stayed away from his friends that didn't. And slowly, over time, he became heavily involved in drugs. One day, a kid had some pills, Xanax and Tramadol, so he tried them. When he was 15, he started drinking, and he was also introduced to opiates, Percocet, for the very first time. So he started taking Perc 30s, which is a stronger opiate, and at that point, he started to steal from his family. He took his dad's pain medication. He was robbing people left and right. When he was 16 years old, he was introduced Percocet that contained heroin of some kind of connection to it. At 17, something switched in his brain, and he didn't know how it happened. But he was then given that connection with the heroin. He said, "Once I started shooting it, I never went back. All the money he earned from his part-time job went to heroin. He was using it whenever and wherever he could, in the bathroom at school, even during his driver's ed class. At one point, he actually poured his heart out to his family and told him what he was doing, lots of pills and heroin. They cried together, began going to counseling as a family. While they were in counseling, Alex lied. Told them he was clean, that he was only smoking weed, but he kept shooting up. During Christmas break, he used every day. Said he spent all his Christmas money on heroin. He stole money from his mom. And then he realized he was at his knees to the addiction, literally stealing Christmas money from his family. So finally, it was just too much. And something clicked in his brain, and he knew he couldn't keep doing this or he was going to die. He was sick of it, sick of stealing. He wasn't functioning very well. His grades were slipping. He was on the verge of not graduating from high school. So on his 18th birthday, he went to detox. Detox lasted about a week, and then the clinician needed to discharge him soon. It was either going to be to a facility with longer care or discharge him to home. Now his parents and his clinician wanted him to go to further treatment, but he was stubborn and he didn't think he needed it. So they were trying to convince him, but he kept refusing, assuring him he'd be fine. He's got this. So his parents made the hour and a half drive home, and he promised them he'd think about it over the next few days. Well, then he found a penny. He decided he was going to flip heads or tails. Heads, he'd go to a facility, or tails, he'd go home. So he rolled that penny to see what side it would land on, and the penny stayed standing on its edge. He realized that he had to make the decision. He wouldn't let the penny decide for him. He knew if he wanted to stay clean, he would have to suck up his pride and go in for further treatment. That's what he did. After treatment, successful, he went back to school full time, started working again, graduated from high school, still goes to meetings, still has a goal for his career. He wants to become a counselor, a licensed drug and alcohol counselor. So he recently started college classes, and that rehab gave him the tools to deal with life on life's terms. It showed him that recovery is possible. It gave him his health and his life back. And he's happier now than he's ever been before in his life. That's a story of success, of overcoming addictions.
That's awesome. Just how God works in that story. You know, like the whole penny thing?
Yeah.
That's just so cool.
Well, there are warning signs, of course, especially as parents, that we can keep out for. But let's just talk about addictions, first of all. You know what? Addictions are basically things that we do in excess. They can be legal, they can be illegal. And there are many facets that come with addictions. Addictions can look like someone who has lost their grip on shopping. You buy for the moment of contentment, only to find it fading as soon as the tags come off of what you purchased. Mm. It could be drugs, it could be alcohol, sex, food, shopping, porn. Anything we do in excess is an addiction. And they always tell you that the first step in addiction and overcoming an addiction, and it's true, is you have to admit that you have a problem. You have to ask God to forgive you for that thing you are doing in excess. And you also have to forgive yourself for judging others whom you view as having a more sinful addiction than yourself. That's just replacing the guilt that you feel and pushing it onto others. Now, there are certain ways you can overcome the addiction yourself and certain things that will help you. And it depends on the seriousness of your addiction. Let's look at the addiction of overeating, which, let's face it, a lot of us have the addiction of overeating from time to time. Or someone who is an alcoholic. One of the painful steps that you have to do is you have to avoid the places that make succumbing to your addiction convenient. So if you like sweets and you are addicted to sugar, which they say that a package of Oreos, eating Oreos, has the same chemical effect on the brain as cocaine. Yeah. So if you have, you know, this addiction, you avoid those places where it's convenient. You avoid going to the bakery section of the grocery store. If you have an addiction maybe to overspending and shopping, you do away with credit cards so you don't have that in your life. If you have an addiction to pornography, you cut internet out of your home. You don't meet a friend at a restaurant that serves alcohol. Or if you have an addiction maybe to a medication that you've been prescribed, you talk to your doctor about weaning you off of that medication. So we admit we have that a problem, but then we also avoid those places where that will be temptation. Another thing you need to do is you need to forgive yourself for your addictions. You are your worst critic more than not, and you're harder on yourself than anyone else.
Amen.
You also have to come to realize that some people in your life may not want to show you compassion or forgiveness, and you can't let that hold you back from seeking a healthier life.
Yeah.
If you look at John 10:10, it says, "The thief does not come to steal, but to kill and destroy. And I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly."
Mm.
Don't allow addiction and the guilt over it to rob you of the abundant life that Jesus has prepared to give you. If that means you have to part ways with some people in your life because of this, pray that he'll give you the strength to do that.
Yeah. If people in your life disagree with you, and you know, like you have your group of friends that smoke weed or drink alcohol, you know, that group, are they truly your friends? You know what I mean? Like
Sometimes you have to give them up.
Well, yeah. And I'm saying, and we always talk about surrounding yourself with good Christian, and not every non-Christian is a terrible person.
Right.
Like, there's that. But I'm just saying, like, if you have a group of friends that you get drunk with or high with, are they truly good friends then? You know what I mean? So just taking that into consideration.
So as followers of Christ, how do we fight addiction? Because guess what?
Yeah.
Christians still deal with addictions. And you can't rate addiction according to some scale. Well, I don't do heroin. But man, I am addicted to Little Debbie snack cakes or something like that. It's, you know, addictions are addictions. Scripture is very clear about our bodies being a temple and how we are supposed to take care and respect our temple, whatever that is. So how do we help fight addictions? One, we got to be honest and we got to be humble. Many of us don't want to admit the reality of our lives and that we have an addiction.
Mm.
We could, of course, bear the thought of telling our 12-step group, but how could we possibly confess this truth to our fellow Christian friends or even in church? We fear judgment and ostracism for having fallen into the web of sin and addictions, so we would rather others not know about it. However, in the process of recovery, nothing less than complete honesty will work. When we are reluctant to be honest, we have to see that the issue is usually pride within ourselves. We don't want people to see that we aren't as perfect as we have pretended to be. But guess what? Managing our image will never get us well.
Yeah.
We have to be humble. We have to be honest with ourselves. We have to carry this spirit into our interactions with others. We can never know when our honesty may save someone who is struggling in need of help. Us being honest and how that can impact others.
Yeah. That's one of the big things that, especially with addiction, you feel so alone that you're like, oh, I'm the only one struggling with this. And you're not. It's crazy to see how many people are also hurting with you and feel alone with you.
They think no one else is dealing with this issue, and that's why they keep it to themselves.
Yeah.
And maybe you actually fessing up, humbling yourself and being honest with yourself and with others, maybe that can be the catalyst for them also speaking up and saying, you know what, I deal with this.
Yeah.
That's powerful. Another thing you can do against the fight against addiction as a follower of Christ, there is strength in facing that temptation. When it comes to fighting addiction temptation, the Bible tells us to be strong, not on our own strength, but on God's. You know, the scripture talks about putting on the armor of God.
Yeah.
But what is this armor that shields us from anything the world can throw at us? It is God's spiritual protection. It is truth, scripture, gospel, and prayer. It's everything we need to stand strong when temptation confronts us. Now, God is not telling us to be strong and then leaving us to fight our greatest enemy alone.
Yeah.
He's telling us that he is the one who fights for us. And our job is to get in fit spiritual condition and to put on that armor. Another thing that's a part of this process is patience. Patience in Christian recovery is a significant challenge that we face. When we finally get clean from whatever that addiction is, we begin to lament the mess that we've made of our lives. Mm. And we think about those missed opportunities and all the things we want to fix and to do better now. So we dive head in, hoping to make up for lost time. And then guess what happens? Those demons are going to rear their ugly heads again. For some, it will come in the form of a slip. Falling off the wagon, as you hear the expression.
Yeah.
Others are going to binge emotionally. We're going to make mistakes, and we will be humbled. We have to remember this. It's in God's economy that nothing is wasted. He is in control. He can restore everything that our addiction steals from us if we only trust him and trust the process that it takes. We get into trouble when we start taking over. And the underlying problem to all this usually is our pride.
Mm.
So what is the answer? Three words. Humility, trust, and patience.
In previous episode, we had a discussion about porn addiction, and I had come out that I had struggled with porn addiction since junior high through high school. The one biggest thing that I have learned is that the reason that we get into addictions is because we're not having God as the center of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a, what's the cheesy song? I have a God-shaped hole.
God-shaped hole.
Yeah. We have a God-shaped hole in our.
Cheesy song?
Well, it's like an old basic Christian song.
Okay.
I get you. But we have a God-shaped hole in our lives. And we're trying to fill these things with porn, with heroin, with earthly things that could never make us happy like God does.
Right.
And the thing is that he's always there. We have to know that he's there, and that's called faith. I tried to fill in other things, and so technically, like, I became addicted to my friends, I became addicted to food, I think having a good group surrounding you where you are completely honest with them is going to help, because they will keep you on the right path of filling that hole that is in your heart with God and nothing else.
Can't do it alone. That's a good step. Actually, here are some ways to help you overcome addiction. First thing is, we need to realize that addiction does not define us.
Mm.
Don't want to over-spiritualize this thing, but Satan, he wants to label you.
Yeah.
He wants you to label yourself. But remember this, what you do does not define who you are. Who are you? Here it is. It's real simple.
I'm a child of God.
Exactly. You are a child of God. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. God's love for you has not diminished or decreased because of your addiction, and it will not. Do you get that? I once heard someone say that you can think of the possibly the worst person to ever live on the planet. Hitler.
Al Capone.
You know, Jeffrey Dahmer, all these mass murderers, whatever, you know, that killed Hitler, you know, responsible for millions of people.
Yeah.
But you know what? God's love for you is the same love that he has for his son, and it's the same love that he has for Hitler. Remember that. God's love for you has not diminished or decreased, and it will not because it isn't dependent upon your behavior. So regardless of how much you are disliking yourself right now in this moment, maybe it's because of an addiction, believe in your true identity as a child of God. Rest in that and then work from that point to overcome. Another thing you need to realize, others are not responsible for your addiction. Our tendency is to blame others, or our tendency is to blame God. Well, this happened in my life and God allowed that to happen, so I'm blaming God. It's easier to blame other people. It's easier to blame the external circumstances of your life because of the addiction that you're in. You're beyond stress from work. You can put in 1,000 excuses if you want, crutches if you will. But remember, you know what a crutch does? A crutch prevents you from walking by yourself. Crutches prevent you from breaking free.
Yeah.
So stop blaming others. Jake, you already sort of mentioned this. You cannot overcome this alone. For years, you'll walk alone. You're ashamed. You're scared. Who wouldn't be? But it is foolish to walk alone and believe you are able to break this cycle. It does not work. In any sort of addiction, you have to tell someone. You have to stop hiding. You can't do it alone. You have to get help. You have to find that accountability partner. Tell your small group. Get counseling. You can't overcome this alone.
Yeah.
Remember this. There is no silver bullet to overcoming addiction. There is no one pill, take this pill, and it'll be gone. No. If you believe following a 10-step process will ensure you overcome whatever addiction, you are misguided. There is no silver bullet. There is no specific 10-step program that's going to do this. Go ahead and read all the self-help books your heart desires. They will not heal you. There's no quick fix to an addiction. It takes time. It's not easy. The road to recovery is filled with people who are looking for that magic potion.
Yeah.
Those who make it to the other side are the ones who have one thing in common, perseverance. Mm. They don't look for a shortcut. They fight, they struggle, they crawl, they run, but they never give up. Another thing, stop setting long-term goals and simply ask God for strength to win each day. If you do that, if you set long-term goals, you're going to be discouraged.
Yes.
6 months, 1 year out.
Yeah.
And then you fail to reach it. And guess what? The monster looks bigger and bigger. Overcoming addiction happens when you get out of bed every morning and ask God for the strength to resist for that day.
Day to day.
Well, that's why we celebrate. You know, people have, you know, I have friends who dealt with alcoholism and went through AA. And so they celebrate. That's why they, you know,
the pins.
9 month pin or whatever. Whatever. Yeah. But it's day by day. It's not long-term goals.
Yeah.
Because what happens when you do that? When you ask God for strength for each day, that's what's going to happen. You're going to start winning weeks and then months and then years.
Yeah.
Don't worry about long-term goals. They are meaningless in the initial stages of addiction. Focus on winning each day. And lastly, God can handle your frustrations and anger. You will be very angry, upset, frustrated. You may think you have to fight the battle of keeping those feelings to yourself. You think God wouldn't be okay with my anger and frustration. He wouldn't understand. But guess what? Look in Scripture. People struggled in Scripture. And if you notice, many of them responded in a way that you wouldn't think is normal. They were honest. They were transparent. Look at King David. He was really honest with God. If God is not big enough to handle me yelling and venting and my anger, then he's not a God worth serving. So go ahead and tell God how you feel. If you need to close the door, close the door. If you need to go off into the woods, go off into the woods. If you need to ride down the road, be transparent with God. He's going to listen. He will hear you. Bottom line, God hates addiction. He wants to help you out of it. And he wants to celebrate with you as you overcome it. If you're dealing with an addiction, there are many, many helps out there. And if you need assistance finding a help, no matter what your addiction is, reach out to us through the Kitchen Table group on our Facebook page. shine.fm Facebook, the Kitchen Table Group. Send us a private message. That's perfectly okay. And we will help find you resources.
Oh.
And that's our faith discussion for today.
Now moving into Music Matters.
So in Music Matters, we celebrate these generational differences of music. Again, of course, I am dad, Jake is son, so we come from different generations.
Wait,
I am a Gen X.
You're my dad?
Yeah.
Oh.
You knew that. You've known that for a while.
Just kidding.
I'm a Gen Z. You're a Gen Z. I'm a Gen X.
Yeah.
And we celebrate the differences there.
I'm an older Gen Z, you know? We have our own thing.
You're called a cusper.
A cusper?
A cusper. That's what they call the few years between the transitions of generations. So.
Hi, I'm a cusper.
Because I'm sort of closer, I'm an early Gen X, closer to baby boomer. So that tweaks the characteristics of your generation just a bit. So, but we get sidetracked. Music matters. We celebrate the generational differences of music. I have a fun song today. I like all kinds of music.
Yeah, you do.
All kinds of music. It doesn't matter stylistically.
You don't like metal, though.
It's okay.
We learned that last week.
That's not true. I like metal from like the 1980s when you could understand the lyrics.
Valid. And
I don't think it's, you might argue that, well, you're just old now, so you don't understand. But I don't get the whole screamo thing, so. I don't understand it, so. But you know what? If it reaches people, I'm cool with that.
Yeah.
But this song is actually a song. I saw the video online several months ago. I've sort of been saving this. I love this song by probably one of the most popular singers on the planet, Andrea Bocelli, who is opera for the most part and blind. Amazing voice.
Mm-hmm.
He does, you know, different languages, but his son Matteo and him did a song. I don't know when it came out, last year, earlier this year.
You showed me the video. I think it was last year.
But I love it because it's a song basically about that father-son relationship called Fall on Me. And when you look at the parallelism of father-son as in Heavenly Father to us, it also plays into that. I mean, the chorus says, fall on me with open arms, fall on me from where you are, fall on me with all your light. Powerfully moving song. I'm going to play a little snippet of it here. I encourage you to check out the video online just to see the interaction between Andrea and his son, Matteo, and how you know, their bond is as a father-son as well. So here's a little bit of Andrea Bocelli and Matteo Bocelli. It's called Fall on Me.
Yeah, I remember seeing that music video. It's really cool. Also, you can tell your Spanish accent is coming out.
That's Italian.
Andrea Bocelli.
You live in Argentina, which they say is like 72% Italian heritage that comes out. So
it's funny. My song for the week. I'm in ministry teams through Olivet, where I go to college, and we just started our semester traveling. So we wrapped up our summer traveling about 4 weeks ago now. We have started the semester, so we go to a lot of churches during the semester on the weekend. And so last weekend, we were traveling, and one of my bandmates, who we have like unassigned assigned seats on our bus, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
they're kind of like, oh, I called dibs on that seat, and so we just sit there. My across the aisle bus buddy, I guess.
Yeah, uh-huh.
My friend Peyton, she's an acoustic guitarist and vocalist in my band. She has a interesting taste in music. She's like open concept, like very vibey.
Sure.
As you like to say. And I'm very like drum driven, obviously, because I play drums. But she showed me this song, and it's called Deeper, and it's by SEU Worship. And it's a cool song because it's very open. And then when the bridge hits, it just goes drums and it gets like a groove finally. And it's really cool. It's talking about, I feel like these past like few episodes, we've been talking about like finding answers with our faith and all that. And so the first line is, I've been searching for answers. I've been hiding my shame, which ties along with this. And there's nothing I found but to put all my trust in your ways. And it's just, it's a really cool song.
It's good.
So here's a little snippet of Deeper by SEU Worship.
I really like that. Yeah, that's a great message.
Yeah, it's a good song. So shout out to Peyton.
For sharing the song.
Yeah.
All right, it's time now for our oldie but goldie. So oldie but goldie, we go back in time. We pull out a hit from days gone by so we can continually introduce this generation to awesome music from our generation parents. And this one, we've shared this guy on our program before, an oldie but goldie, but I wanted to bring up another one. This is from 1993. It's a number two song from that year, and it's from Rich Mullins. Rich, of course, incredible lyricist. He painted beautiful canvas with words in his songs. Tragically, he was killed in an automobile accident 22 years ago this month. We'll be celebrating that tragic event. But this is a song that speaks to so many people who might be in the grips of an addiction and without hope and looking for answers. This one's called Hold Me, Jesus, Rich Mullins from 1993.
I'm singing, hold me, Jesus.
That's a good one.
I just love that song. It's one of my favorite songs ever.
You've showed me Rich Mullins before.
Absolutely. Any parent from my generation who doesn't is not a parent, in my opinion. There you go. I said it.
Well, that wraps up Music Matters. And now moving into Culture Shock.
All right, Culture Shock is our final segment for today. We do this, of course, each and every week. We find something that's happening in culture. Maybe someone who's
made a difference.
It's a plethora of topics. Today, with just an incredible story that I found about an incredible song and how it caused an incredible reaction. I don't like using the word incredible over and over again, but there's just no other way about it.
Incredible.
Yeah. So here's the story. Nearly 3 years after the murder of Cesar Lopez Flores, his killer pleaded guilty, saying he found God while he was incarcerated, which urged him to confess. In a statement that shocked the court, Danny Holmes pleaded guilty minutes after his trial began last week, confessing to the murder of Lopez Flores. On Friday, the circuit court judge David Bragg's packed courtroom, Holmes officially pleaded guilty to the indictment, including charges related to first-degree murder, kidnapping, robbery, and criminal impersonation of law enforcement. He'll serve a life sentence in prison, one which he says he'll wear as a badge of honor. Holmes fatally shot Lopez Flores on December 16th, 2016. He kidnapped Brittany Johnson, who he forced to drive to the Lopez Flores' home, and that's where he killed him and fled the scene. In a lengthy 20-minute statement, Holmes addressed the court, explaining his decision to confess to the murder. He said over a year ago, God changed his life. He felt as if God was putting pressure on him to tell the truth and to confess to the murder. This is what Holmes says. I knew the Lord was just on me, weighing on me over and over. I'm 30 years old, and I've been fighting for nothing all my life. I've been fighting for gangs. I ain't never fought for anything that made sense. But I knew the Lord was testing me to fight for him this time. I just knew he was stirring on my spirit. So the question is, what led Holmes to confess? It was a song by Big Daddy Weave. He brought a notebook with him to the trial with the lyrics to the song Redeemed. He says, and if I didn't tell the truth, I should have never brought that notebook. After reading the lyrics, then you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight that's already been won. He made up his mind. He was going to tell the truth. He was going to confess to a murder. The redemption tale struck a chord with those in the courtroom. As Holmes spoke, the room filled as people wandered in to hear the confession. His family sobbed during the statement. Holmes says, Mama, I know I love you, but Mama, I promise you, your baby boy, he's going to serve the Lord forever. Holmes recounted his flashy lifestyle to the court. He had made money, lots of it, designer goods, expensive cars. Now he plans to tell all young people he meets in prison about finding salvation through Jesus, not cash or luxuries. He shared that he's been praying for the victim's family. He learned while incarcerated that Lopez Murphy was a father of three children. This struck Holmes, a father himself. He realized his actions robbed three girls from a life with their father. He said, my consequences deserve a life sentence. That's powerful.
Yeah.
That is incredible. I just wanted to share that for Culture Shock. I read that and was just blown away.
Yeah. Unexpected story.
How God can use something like that.
That's awesome.
So that's Culture Shock. And it brings a wrap to this week's episode of The Kitchen Table. Thank you so much for hanging out with us this week. Again, if you're struggling with some sort of addiction and you're wanting resources and you don't know where to turn, there's a great way to get a hold of us. Go to shine.fm on Facebook. Just search shine.fm. And then a group within that Facebook page is called The Kitchen Table. Go to that group. Yeah. If you want to send a private message through the Facebook page to us, please do so. We will help you in any way we can.
Yeah. Have a great week, y'all. Stay salty.
Thanks for listening to The Kitchen Table on the Shine.fm podcast network from Olivet Nazarene University. Be sure to subscribe for more content delivered each week on faith, music, and culture.